I'm the president of the United Nations Association San Francisco chapter. Our chapter and our organization was founded in 1943 and was the predecessor, the predication, for the founding of the United Nations here in San Francisco. Ironically, while the United States prides itself in advising other countries about how to enforce and implement human rights, we here have had the experience in the Bay Area of being visited by a UN special rapporteur. Philip Alston, and his report is up at the front table. It's an extensive report, and some of it's good news. Lots of good things are happening, and you can see at the back of the room, lots of good things are happening with nonprofits just pitching in and lending a hand and saying, if the government won't do it, we'll do it. And so we have that incredible spirit with us this evening. We also have some bad news, and the bad news is that we see it very visibly on our streets here in San Francisco, and we're aware of the long food lines of people who are hungry, and we're even becoming aware that our students in universities are food insecure, maybe as many as 20% are food insecure, and maybe as many as 40% have experienced homelessness at one time. So it's affecting everyone, and it could be me, it could be someone else in this room that suddenly has that traumatic experience. So we were looking at 20 topics dealing with the Universal Declaration of Human Rights. We started this series and said it was going to be about homelessness, and lo and behold, it's turning out to be a very pivotal time in the city for public policy and dealing with this situation. And Nelson had agreed to take on this topic and to put together this incredible panel and all of these incredible nonprofit organizations. It is Nelson's generosity and his willingness to spend maybe 50% of his time putting this incredible program together. Nelson Berry.
We're very fortunate to have this opportunity to, on behalf of the United Nations Association of San Francisco, in conjunction with the American Legion Post 315, to present this program in our continuing series on human rights. And this year, this month, we're picking homelessness in San Francisco. And it's really a hot topic right now, obviously. Last week, the mayor decided, after getting some bad press from conventioneers, that we may not come back here to San Francisco because it's not really pretty. But what city in America doesn't have a homeless challenge? That's a shot below the belt for us San Franciscans. I'm a native San Franciscan. On my mother's side, we go back 5 generations here in San Francisco. My grandmother, in 1906, on April 18th, was rolled out of bed at the age of 11 onto the floor of the 1906 earthquake. And for the next several decades, they rebuilt San Francisco from Venice Avenue all the way to the Bay, because that's how much of the city was destroyed. And that's the can-do attitude we have. And just 40 years later, in 1945, the United Nations Declaration was signed in this building downstairs, a proud history that we have. And 4 years later, in 1949, the Universal Declaration on Human Rights was promulgated. And number 25 says, I want to get it right. There we go. Article 25 of the 1948 Universal Declaration of Human Rights leads off by saying, everyone has the right to a standard of living adequate for the health and well-being of himself and his family. Kind of says something about the day and age. including food, clothing, housing, and medical care. 1945. We live in a time when social services are being cut at the federal level, so more pressure is on the cities and states to pick up the slack. But San Francisco has wonderful men and women who are at the forefront of dealing with social issues like homelessness, and we have some of the best here today representing dozens of organizations that are working hard to bring in some compassion and treat homeless people in a humane, compassionate way. Some of those people, as Mary said, are represented by the organizations in the back of the room. I hope you'll stop by and talk to each and every one of them. Miracle Messages teaches you how to, they give you an app, and you on your own phone, when you encounter a homeless person, you can say to them, have you talked to your family in a while? Would you like to talk to your family? And if they don't, yeah, I might, but I don't know how to get a hold of them. So Miracle Messages teaches you how to find people, and then you use the app, and it doesn't cost you anything. It doesn't cost you a dime. And you can put that person in touch with their family, and they've reunited many, many homeless people with their families just through that little act of kindness using a little bit of technology. And we have Project Homeless Connect, which is, I'm going to give it a general overview, but I love this organization because of what they do. They go out and they find homeless people who have particular needs, and there are dozens of organizations out there to help the homeless, and they try to direct the person to the organization that's going to help them with that particular need, be it help with mental health issues or drug addiction, or they need job skills, or they need medical care, then the list goes on. So we've got lots of organizations here that are doing really great. Angela, come on up. And since 1997, she's been a successful anti-discrimination attorney and won landmark discrimination cases against corporations. She was first elected to the Board of Supervisors in 1988 and re-elected in 1992, and served as the president of the board from 1993 to 1995. So she obviously knows about San Francisco politics from a first-hand point of view. She has been a big advocate for preserving social service programs and a big advocate for those who are disenfranchised in our community or would like to see them disenfranchised, the poor, people of color, women, LGBT groups. And she's also a grandmother of five. So please give her a warm welcome.
I kind of live this and have for many years. I have to say that speaking in front of Jennifer is like very difficult for me. You know, I don't know if anyone would ever want the moniker of the grandmother of all homelessness, but she really is. She's been out in the streets doing the job for so long now. And seeing Michael from Swords, you guys don't get old. You look the same you did 20 years ago. It's amazing. And Colleen, I've been Franciscan my whole life, and so I know it's somewhat of an addiction to want to help and make sure that the poor don't live on the streets the way they do. Running in this mayor's race has been fascinating because people are offering programs that just simply, when you've been doing it as long as I have been doing it, you just know it's not going to work, and it's almost like a trick on the people. It's almost like saying, we know this is going to work, it's tried and true, which of course it isn't, it just simply cannot work. One of my opponents, or one of the people running, actually says they're going to end, totally, homelessness by 2020. Well, that's in 2 years, and that would be a serious St. Francis miracle that I would like to see. What dawns on me, though, when you're listening to Jennifer and Colleen and Project Homeless Connect, which was an absolute genius program, just genius in what it does, and listening to Michael with the vets, I'm so glad to hear that it's down.
because, you know, 10, 15 years ago, the beds were something like 42% or very high amount of the homeless population. What occurs to me when you listen to the experts in the field is I feel like we're just missing how to do it. Like we're just like right at the tipping point because we've got all this expertise, we've got the numbers, we understand it. We're just missing exactly what it's going to take to end poverty, to end poverty. And a lot of people don't know that when you see people sitting out on the street, they're not all homeless. I mean, I met two guys the other day when we were sweeping the streets to clean the dirty streets, two guys that, you know, have a unit, but they just want to be outside. This is a very, very particular problem that we have. Let me go back to the 10-year plan. In 2004, I endorsed Gavin Newsom in the runoff if he would let me have some control over where homelessness went because I didn't like Care Not Cash. Today, I'm not sure if Care Not Cash ever worked. I don't think it did because what I see it happening is that beds get reserved because it's a contract and people, there are 1,000 people waiting every night to get a bed and then they're empty beds. The whole shelter system, I am not crazy about. But having said that, we did the 10-year plan to end chronic homelessness. We had about 60 people in a room, and what I loved about it was that there were people that didn't like each other. You know, there was the hotel council, the restaurant council, the archdiocese, Jennifer, the coalition, people that severely disagreed on the issues of how to handle this situation, and yet they sit there for 6 months and created a really good, in my opinion, first of all, the civil relationships were wonderful, and that's something that's totally lacking today in city government. But secondly, we came out with a program that it really works. It really works, and it's permanent supportive housing for those that can do permanent supportive housing. And permanent supportive housing are three words that have an analysis to each word. They're not just a word. It's an analysis of the type of triage that the particular homeless person would have in order to get to the part of supportive and housing. An actual unit with a refrigerator and a stove and a bathroom, an actual unit. So we put several buildings in the pipeline to be built. We actually used 8 of them out of the 19 that were put into the pipeline. Now, what happened was in 2012, when Gavin left and a new mayor came on, and then tech came into town without a plan. I love tech, it's exciting and all that, but there was no plan. And a lot of us in San Francisco got pretty cheated by what happened to the city itself when tech came into town, because if there's no plan for the infrastructure and you're bringing in all these new employees that are taking apartments and making other people go be out in the street, whether it's by the Ellis Act or whether it's by buying people out, the bottom line situation is they're in the streets. They're in the streets. And then you have this massive explosion of homelessness from 2012 to today, and the tents that started in around 2015, that makes it more chronic, in my opinion, and more homelessness, in my opinion, than we had when we started in 2004. But the lack of recidivism of those that we housed, in other words, over 4,600 people that we housed, are 94% of them are still in the unit we put them in. That is a phenomenal success. Phenomenal. It is phenomenal. This is very, very hard work. I've seen Jennifer be in a car with someone taking them to get their SSI or GI, or Christy Fairchild over at North Beach. This is working mano a mano, one on hand with people. I've been in situations many times in my life where I'm with a homeless person in the car, and it's not a great situation because you think everything's going to be okay, and they have problems that you have to be an expert to understand these problems. Though I have to admit, I've gotten very good at triaging homeless people. I've gotten very good at understanding which direction they should go, but the direction is definitely off the street in any event. So one of my biggest problems, and I know this is politically not nice and all the rest of that, but I'm not here to be politically nice. I'm here to take poor people off the street. I'm running what I'm running for right now, because one of our puppies, who was 18 years old, was sick. And in fact, he died that night. And we took him down to Alabama Street. And I could, to the hospital, there's an animal hospital down there. I could not believe the tents. I just simply could, it looked like a third world. Looked like a third world. People literally were sitting there at 1 o'clock in the morning eating off the street. It was inconceivable to me that we have arrived at that point, which is why I'm now running for what I'm running for. I wouldn't have otherwise gotten into this race. If it hadn't been for the amount of poverty on the streets. And after that, I went around and started investigating and called the coalition, called Christy, called Roar, and asked them, well, what are the numbers now? Because, you know, Michael, these numbers are not, and Jennifer, these numbers are not that different than they were in 2004, except that the veterans have gone down considerably, which is fantastic. And of course, I want to know more about that. But the problem is, these programs that are temporary. If you put someone that's triple diagnosed or mental illness or alcohol and drug abuse, let's say you put someone in a drug abuse program, and they go through it, and 4 months later, they're doing really well, they're clean and sober, and it's time that they move on, and even possibly looking for a job, you cannot just put them back into the street. You can't do it. And we have millions and millions and millions of dollars in San Francisco's contracts of programs that put you back into the street. There's got to be a net at the end, especially with mental health. There's got to be a net either into transitory housing that eventually results in permanent supportive housing or results in some kind of medical facility or in-home care or something where the person is not back on the streets. So if you get those programs to try to work with you and not put people back on the street, that would be a huge, huge help. The other side of it is preventing homelessness, and that's in the area of evictions. I'm a civil rights trial lawyer. I travel all over the United States representing, you know, the sick, the poor, race, national origin, sexual orientation. It's incredible to me who these big corporations put out on the street. When they're disabled. Incredible. If you have Parkinson's, forget it. You lose your job, and by the way, at 62 years old, you're not gonna get another job. So where does that leave your apartment? Where does that leave you, your future? If you don't have family, you end up out in the street. And quite frankly, if it weren't for rent control, things would be innumerably worse. So having said that, it's really important to look at the root causes, but I honestly believe we're right at a tipping point to figure out how we can have the tech industry, that by the way got a tax incentive, that's pretty incredible, while the small businesses didn't, but how they who really do want to help can actually help with where we want them to help, not where they want to help, but where it's just the opposite of what the young lady was saying about, you know, give the homeless person a choice. Let's give tech an idea of where they could put the money that would really help us get people off the street and work together. There are no coalitions in San Francisco, and the one that's most definitely needed is tech, government, and the community. Working together to solve a problem, I don't think there's any problem that we can't solve at all. I'm assuming my time's up because you stood up.
Is it up?
No, just thank you all so much. I would like nothing more. There's a whole wide world to never see a poor person on the streets, and especially in a city of such great compassion like San Francisco. So all of you do a great job. Just the fact that you're here on a Sunday afternoon is formidable, and thank you so very much.